that you have had your music used in programmes such as The OC?
I never have seen this programme, so I don't... That was very German put together. I did just spend a day in Berlin, and it's like, I never have seen... Anyway, yes.
Wikipedia tells me that you have you've had music featured on the soundtrack of an Ashton Kutcher movie, or Kutcher, I'm not sure how you pronounce it. Yeah, One Tree Hill, The OC, Grey's Anatomy, Scrubs, CSI Miami. I don't know if this is the same song that's been used in all of those.
No, I don't think so.
But perhaps a romantic love scene in The OC, some kind of gruesome dissection of a corpse in CSI Miami.
Yes.
Who knows?
It could be the same song for both, actually.
Absolutely, yeah. And of course, UK listeners may sort of know you from the track Strange and Beautiful and Brighter Than Sunshine, and then you sort of disappeared for one, and you've been in the States, and you found a whole sort of new lease of life over there. But do you feel that you've not quite sort of found your audience in the UK?
I don't know. I mean, we've found an audience.
Sure.
I
found an audience, that means nothing.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I suppose most people will find one.
Exactly.
Some, your mum will listen. I don't know, it does feel like it would be nice to come and have this record come out sort of properly and maybe see if we can, having found out that there are other parts of the world that do to kind of like what we're doing, it kind of gives us a bit more confidence in some ways and think, well, maybe we can convince the UK again to listen. It'd be nice if they did. It's so much nearer home.
Yeah. Well, we were mentioning earlier, we were talking off air about the fact that you once had one of your tracks used in The Archers.
Radio
program. Was that a big thrill? Because people often say that it's great when they hear their records sort of being played in the CAF on EastEnders.
Yes. Well, that was our, because we the kind of household we were in growing up was much more of a Archer's household than a EastEnders one. So that was very exciting when we were in the background in the bull, whatever it was.
Because I have a real problem with the Archers. Like, my parents will often listen to it, and if I'm in the car with them, I'll listen. And I can't, I've never heard any incident happen on that show. It's just endless kind of people walking in and saying, do you want a cup of tea? I'll have a cup of tea, yeah. I might go down to the town crier exhibition.
There's quite a lot of lifting acting. Most scenes in the Archers start with someone going,
yeah. Ah,
hello, David. How
and
are
it's
you?
Also, it's that getting off of a horse or on off of a tractor, which is, as you say, kind of John.
Just give me a hand with this.
Yeah.
That sort of thing.
Yeah. I think if you listen to it and imagine it's been written by Samuel Beckett, it's actually quite a lot.
I know
more
what you mean. Yeah. I remember that Alistair McGowan once said the same of Terry Wogan's radio programme, which again I've never quite understood. What I know it's hugely popular, but I can't. I mean, not much as I love him, but it's I never know when he's telling an anecdote or reading a letter or just whilst walking in the Maldives. My wife and I... Is this you talking, Terry, now? Are you reading a letter? What's going on? But listen, you're going to play another track from the... is this another track from the forthcoming album?
It is, yes.
What's this one called?
This is called Pressure Suit.
OK, we'll look forward to it. Aquila. Round of applause in the Steve Wright car. We had to let it fade right out there in case we want to put it on some kind of future Best of the Steve Show session. So no worry, you'll be getting a cut of that, I'm sure. Now, that was the track Pressure Suit?
Yes.
I've got the notes here. It tells me that's released as a single July 30th.
Could be.
The album Memory Man is out August the 6th, and apparently the previous track you played, Cinderella, is available as a download only on June 11th.
Sounds very likely.
Good. I'm glad to see you're well across all of that.
Entirely plausible.
Now, of course, there's two brothers there. You're both in the band. I guess you tour. Is it kind of Gallagher's-esque? Do you fight? Do you squabble? Do you throw punches?
We can't be bothered.
Right.
Really.
To answer that question, or
no,
just
no,
generally?
No, that'd be excellent. I can't ask another question. I can't be bothered to answer that.
Well, we've had an email from Claire, who's a fan. She says she loves hearing you play now. She wants to ask, any rumours that you'll be playing at Glastonbury? If not, is there a UK tour anytime soon?
We are playing at Glastonbury on the Friday. Is that right? No, maybe the Sunday, one of the days. Anyway, right. Sorry, I get confused.
People can check the Glastonbury website, for goodness sake. You're not expected to know all this information. You're a songwriter, an artist.
Thanks. That's a relief, actually. we're doing that. We're doing that. Doing Latitude, which is another nice festival, and then we'll be touring properly in probably October, I think.
Now, a lot of the people who tune into Six Music are real music obsessives. One of them is our friend Sammy. She came in a couple of weeks back. We were trying to recruit a woman to appear on the show because it's quite laddish. Anyway, she's a massive Aqualung fan, and I don't know why we didn't ask her to come down today. I feel terribly guilty about that.
Upset.
She's really upset. But this is a question which I think would only be of interest to you and her. She says, I wanted to know for 3 years now, when you did a Christmas concert in London, December 2004, you played an odd and gorgeous piano-type thing. It was small, it was cloth-bound, and it sounded incredibly plinky. It didn't sound like a piano, nor did it sound like a harpsichord. What was it?
Right. That was a celeste.
A celeste?
The actual answer is a celeste, which is a lovely instrument that sounds like a glockenspiel, but you play it like a piano.
Well, she says that the new album is stunning.
Thank you, Sammy.
We are. So we've answered that question for Sammy. It was presumably of only interest to her. But that's a great thing. When you've only got a handful of listeners, you can literally ask all the questions that they've sent in, which is very, very sweet. Now, there was rumour that you may be willing to hang around and play a cover version for us, because we always sort of play a cover version every week. So
of course, you'll
do something after the news. We'll have to play jingles and music and stuff. We'll come back. We'll talk to Aklung before they play a cover after the news. So, of course, yeah. Is it me speaking? Hello, sorry, we were coming back in from the hub. We're racing around because, obviously, we've got to go to the hub, which is a kind of performance area if you are new to Six Music. We will, as I say, hear a cover version from Aqualung after the news, plus we've got some music from... I'd like to play that Monkeys tune, Jude, so we'll play that out the back of the news. Yeah, great. All right, here's the news.
What about that?
It's amazing.
Oh, wonderful.
That's a cracking little sort of forgotten gem by the Monkeys, of all people. That, weirdly enough, is actually the B-side to Daydream Believer. Amazingly. And it's called Going Down, and I think that's an absolute gem. We will definitely be playing that again. In future weeks, it's a Steve Show, BBC Six Music, with me, Stephen Merchant. We are almost at the end of the show. Before we leave, we will have a final cover version performed live by Aqualung in the Hub. Prior to that, we will have a choice from Harry, but you want to talk briefly about the Monkeys?
Yeah, just a very brief Monkey story. A friend of my girlfriend's dad encountered Davy Jones on a plane. And Davy was being very rude to the air stewardess, apparently, demanding this, demanding that, where's my drink, you know, got very, very, very leery with it. And this guy said, look, calm down, mate, she's doing her best, you know, she's doing her job, just leave it. And he went, don't tell me to calm down. He said, I'm just saying calm down. He said, don't you know who I am? He said, I don't give a monkey's who you are, mate.
Nice. Did you just libel Davy Jones?
No. There's no proof that Davy ever did misbehave on a plane.
No, exactly. That's what I was just going to say. There's no evidence for that whatsoever.
No, so that would not be at all. Loads.
So, you know, you're not saying that happened.
I'm in the clear. I think I'm in the clear. Jude, am I in the clear legally?
Yeah. Dubious, but, you know, as you say, it's a story and you don't know that it's...
No, exactly.
We have no proof that happened.
Yeah. We've washed over the punchline now. It's all gone. The story's dead.
Yeah.
Let's move on.
Let's move on. That's it. Yeah. Okay, so we had a choice from Rufus earlier. Oddly enough, it was the 45s. Harry, you're going to choose something for us.
Yeah, last week after playing Heavy Trash, I briefly mentioned Madder Rose, and it set me thinking because I hadn't heard their stuff for a while. So I went back to the albums and remembered how much I loved their debut album, which is called Bring It Down. It was released in 93. Funnily enough, listener Alex Jones had the same sort of thoughts. He's emailed in and he wants us to play Car Song. We're not going to play that. I picked Beautiful John, which is the opening track off the album, and it's a corker.
Harry, what was the name of the tune?
That's Beautiful John by Madder Rose. Now, do you remember why we didn't see them play that track when we went to Reading in 93?
I don't.
Well, what it was the first day of the festival. We'd all arrived the night before. I had a look around. We weren't too confident about how it was going to go. It was the days before mobile phones. So if we all got lost, how would we get back in touch with each other? It would have been impossible. So we decided...
You'd never see me in a crowd.
Exactly. Sure. We all decided to, you know, leave the tent together first thing in the morning, just about to go in time to catch Madder Rose. And you, in a show of legendary thrift, thought, hang on, there's all those caravans selling burgers at £4 a pop. I'm going to cook a tin of beans. You
really?
You pulled out this ridiculous little camping stove and we had to sit for 25 minutes while you cooked this little tin of beans and chopped them down.
This.
And myself and our good friend Goli were livid, absolutely
livid. I don't even like beans. Are you sure it was me?
Maybe it was spaghetti hoops. I'm not sure.
That sounds more like it. With tiny sausages in.
Yeah. Yeah, we were angry then.
Well,
hang on a minute. I'm still angry now.
It makes me wonder, though, perhaps if you were hanging around for some of those beans and sausages. Because you could have
never got
nicked off and watched Madder Rose, couldn't you? Suddenly you're bringing this back. I bet you had a tasty little treat before you went off and see the bands that day.
Well, I went and paid for some food later because I'm not quite as tight as you.
Well, why were you sat around watching me cook beans? You could have gone. You're your own man.
Oh, it was the days before mobile phones. We were all young, naive. We weren't the outdoor
types. You've got to let that go, Harry. For goodness sake. Listen, I've got you live on the radio. You're here watching musicians play live.
Actually,
look how much I'm repaying you now.
I take it all back. I forgive you.
Thank you very much indeed. We're back in the hub with Aqualung. A little round of applause, please, and the Steve Wright staff as we welcome them back, because they're going to play a cover version for us, which is very sweet of them. I feel like I should probably just do a bit more plugging for you guys. Your album's out August 6th.
That's right.
Okay, before that, Pressure Suit is out as a single July 30th.
I think all right, that's correct.
I think I have filled a number of contractual obligations. So what's the cover that you're going to do for us, man?
This is a song by Wilco, probably my favourite new, well, living band. Maybe the best band in the world, I don't know. And it's a song from the last record Ghost is Born called Muzzle of Bees.
Brilliant. Well, let's enjoy that. Ladies and gentlemen, Aqualung. Live music on Six Music. It's The Steve Show and it's Aqualung adding money to the coffers of Wilco by doing a cover version of what was the track?
Muzzle of Bees.
Muzzle of Bees. Round of applause, please, for Aqualung. Thank you so much, guys, for coming in. Can I just check with you, Matt, before you go? Is it right that, and this is again according to Wikipedia, at the age of 17 you wrote your first symphony?
First and last.
Right. And is that available to download, perhaps?
I hope not.
Okay. Was it good? I mean, genuinely, what did it
say? No, I think it was really, really quite awful.
If you have a copy of Life Cycle, which I believe is what it was called, then please get in touch at the usual address. Thanks again. The final round of applause, please, for Aqualung. Thank you, guys. Thank you very much indeed. If you haven't seen it, it's worth checking out that little Will Ferrell comedy, romantic comedy that came out recently called Stranger Than Fiction. Mm. It was excellent. And it's kind of a bit like Groundhog Day meets something by Spike Jonze, in which Will Ferrell discovers that he's inside someone else's novel. Mm. And that's one of the tracks that was featured on the soundtrack. It was Spoon and the Book I Write. Remember a couple of weeks back, maybe it's even a month now, Six Music was trying to find the worst lyrics of all time. Mm. And I mentioned that I'd heard that terrible song by Morrissey, Sorrow Will Come to You in the End. And it took me a while to track it down because it was only available on one of his American releases, and we've got it here for you, and we're coming in, I think, at the second verse. And if let me just remind you of the setup for the song. Do you remember he was in a court case, I think, with Johnny Marr, and the rest of the Smiths sued them for lack of royalties or something. Anyway, Morrissey lost, and he was very annoyed, and he obviously tried to vent his spleen in this song, Sorrow Will Come. And I just think, let's just let it speak for itself.
A man who slits throats has time on his hands, and I'm gonna get you.
I'm gonna get you.
He's gonna do the killing. That's such a toothless threat.
What's the worst that Morrissey could do to you, then?
Morrissey?
Yeah. He'd write something nasty on a blog.
Yeah.
But. I think he'd spill red wine deliberately on a beige carpet in your house.
Yeah.
That's the worst.
He'd say something very unkind about your mother-in-law.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
He'd sign you up to PETA. But it was it's like you say, it's just a spoken word thing to get it across, and the music is so pompous. If it'd been Johnny Marr with a twinkly little rhythm, and he'd be going, "The man has slits throats, has time in his hands," then he could have got away with it. But doing it like that, oh no, it didn't work.
It didn't work. Well, there you are. Sorry, we'll come to us in the end. and that's pretty much the end of the show, I'm afraid. I have to thank Harry and Rufus, of course, around for the Steve Wright style. Thanks to Jude. Thanks to Aqualung for playing live. You can check out the website if you want to contribute anything. Six Music, before Pharrell Williams was ubiquitous on every single hip-hop record. Now I think it's law that he has to feature. He had a band, of course, called NERD, and they put out a couple of sort of funk rock hip-hop LPs, and from the first one of those, In Search Of, I will leave you with Bobby James. Thanks again, guys, to you. We'll be back next week. Will we have a CJ, Jude?
Yes, we will.
Will we?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
You should have got Sammy back this week. She's devastated that she didn't get to see her favourite band of all time.
Sammy.
I don't know what else it is that you're doing with your time, but think, Jude, please. Think, woman. All right, we've got obligations to people. These are our listeners. There's only a handful of them.
I'm going to start the record, so leave me alone.
See you next week. Man who opened the Woodstock Festival in 1968, that's Richie Havens and Going Back to My Roots. It's the Steve Show on BBC Six Music with me, Stephen Merchant, and I'm going back to my roots this week in a sense because I'm going to get back to really what this show is all about. My ego. I joke, of course. No, what I mean is music. It's all about the music. And in a sense, if you've not heard the show before, this is a sort of musical brothel in which I parade, you know, various kind of musical trollops in front of you, and you decide which ones take your fancy, and you can take them in the back room and do with them as you will. And of course, I'm not the only one pimping the songs, because I have with me, of course, various cronies who also contribute music to the show. In the far corner there, it's Harry. Say hi.
Hi. Afternoon.
With me, tiny, tiny, tiny little Daniel, who has been absent for a while, but we welcome him back.
Hello.
And listen to that tiny little voice. And then, of course, there's only one man, and he's so posh. It's obscene. It disgusts me. It's Rufus.
Hello, Steve. Listen. Hello, listeners.
What's the